and roll. Hello, folks. You're on with Dr. Phil Pavetti, the heart surgeon, Mark Lobliner, the bodybuilder, creator of the Outright Bar. Today, we're talking about what to eat for peak performance from the perspective of a guy who's more ripped than you and a guy who's done way more heart surgeries than you. Mark, welcome to the I Fix Hearts show.
Thank you for having me, man. It's great to be here. And I love the approach you guys take to holistic health. And, you know, you look at doctors and I think just earning the trust back of the community that doctors are in it to make you live longer, not just to kind of, you know, make money, push a pill. We all got to make money. But at the end of the day, I think you get into medicine to help people live longer and better. And that's also what I do. So I personally love doctors who, you know, look at it from that perspective. Right. So very honored to be here.
Yeah. Great to have you here, Mark. Really excited for this discussion. We've been, interacting now for quite a while on social media. And, you know, a lot of the nuance, I guess, as, you know, when it comes to nutritional, dietary, lifestyle approaches, it's kind of difficult to get across there. Yeah. And, you know, a lot of people would maybe look at our two accounts and think we were really putting out like different messaging, but I don't think that's the case. I think there's a lot that we have in common. And then I think there's some nuance that comes to, you know, what your goals are, where you're starting from, what problems you're trying to solve. And that's why I was really excited for us to have this conversation so we can get into some of that and help our audiences maybe decipher some of what would appear to be conflicting information out there.
Well, let's start off with the complex question here, which is that Dr. Vadia, you talk about eat whole real food, as in do not eat things in packages. And you're talking to Mark, that is a company of things that is food in packages. Mark, can you talk about what the Outright Bar is and what you put into it for a minute? So Dr. Vadia can talk about what point does having food in a package as opposed to slaughtering the cow yourself make sense?
Well, at the end of the day, I can't. Okay, so it depends what's in that package, right? So when we created the Outright Bar, we wanted healthy fats. And again, we can argue all day what healthy fats are. I'm looking at monounsaturates, you know, and granted, I can't just put beef tallow in it. That'd be really nasty. So that's when we went nut butter, peanut butter, almond butter, cashew butter are three options. Honey as the carb source, no prebiotic fiber or glycerin. And then we also went with whey protein isolate as the protein source. So that's the base. Now there are inclusions in there in microgram amounts, right? Cause you got to make it taste good. So you put the cookie bits, this, that, and the third, but the base 99% of the bar is going to be comprised of peanut butter, is going to be comprised of whey protein isolate, going to be comprised of honey. Now, again, am I better off if I'm sitting down and having a meal? Maybe we can make that argument all day long, but it's meant to be a snack, right? It's meant to be something you eat to fuel your workouts or whatever. And so that's where the Outright Bar, even though it's in a package, there's a lot of really good, healthy, whole food beef jerky that is found in a package. So just because it's on the perimeter of the grocery store doesn't necessarily make it bad.
Dr. Ovadia, the rebuttal.
Yeah, no, I mean, really, I don't think it's a rebuttal. I think this is a perfect demonstration of kind of the nuance that we get into. And yes, you know, first and foremost, I'm going to say eat whole real food, but certainly recognize that there are times when that might not be practical. And then, you know, what I would say is not all, let's call these protein bars or snack bars, you know, are remotely the same. And so if you are going to go for an option like a protein bar for specific purposes, you know, you're not building your whole nutritional approach around these bars, then, yeah, look for the ones with the cleanest ingredients. And it sounds like, you know, Outright Bar would be high on my list there. And, you know, I guess, like you said, yeah, we can get into all those, you know, maybe beef tallow would be better than, you know, some of these nut butters, or maybe coconut oil versus nut butter. But I also understand, and I'd love to actually hear Mark's perspective on it, because I've never tried to build, you know, produce a protein bar, you know, what some of the nuances that you get into as you know, what's possible versus what's ideal when you're trying to build a snack bar like this.
So I look at supplements as supplements. They don't substitute, they supplement. So you need it to be palatable. Because as much as you look at your enthusiasts or people who follow you, who maybe have had that near death experience, and there's a lot of people who are literally on their last leg with diabetes. I'm not even joking, had their leg chopped off, who still can't put down the candy bar. And you've seen these people probably more than I have, doctor. And so what we try to do is create supplements to help you live a better optimal life, but also food products that are better for you than the alternative, than the Snickers bar, than the moon pie. But also for a fitness enthusiast like me who wants to work out, I want something that I can eat that'll give me, you know, readily available carbohydrate for my training, because intensity of training is different than a desk jockey, as I like to call them. So we can argue all day about the application of carbohydrate and fat in your diet. I'm a fan of both. I'm not against ketogenic diets, but I do think that, you know, the data is pretty demonstrative that carbohydrate do enhance performance in certain activities, especially ones requiring short bursts of energy. Whereas if you're running a marathon, I think a ketogenic diet is actually optimal. So it's a time and place in those nuances that you were talking about, doctor. So what I'm looking at when I produce something is, number one, it has to taste really good. I hate to put taste first, because I'm the kind of guy who I'd eat a brick covered in poop if it made me perform better. However, 99.99% of people won't do that. So as someone who flavors and who formulates foods, number one is I need them to be able to consume it. Number two is I want to use the highest quality possible ingredients. And number three is I have to make it where it doesn't cost $10 a bar, because no one can afford that, especially in today's economy. So those three factors, you have to play a role. So when I'm creating something, I want to create the best thing that'll help the most people possible, and deliver something that I would want to consume. And when I created this bar, it was created for my kids to eat between soccer games. They were playing, my daughter was, I think, 10 or 11 years old, playing center mid. That's about 7 miles of running a game, three games a day. What do you can't feed her a candy bar. The protein bars are full of prebiotic fiber, which will not be optimal for when performing. Can't really eat a whole food meal between games. If you've ever performed at that level of running, it's very tough to digest. So that was the reason I created it. And it happened that it was not meant to blow up like it did. It was just literally meant for my family to consume and maybe a few of our customers direct. And then it just hit off, because it appears that most people are looking to fill that void. So as much as you and I, as someone who cares, who has worked in health and fitness my entire adult life, and you as someone who wants to see less people on your operating table, we want to give people options that will help them, not hurt them, to give them sustenance to basically optimize their day.
I have a story that's gross before Dr. Vedia shows his next story. I used to be actively a mountain climber, and I was going up Glacier Peak, the fifth tallest mountain in Washington State, I think. And I was read about this whole carnivore thing and this whole avoiding carbs. And I thought, yeah, I'm going to get after this. And Mike Mutzel, bless his heart, told me, you cannot actually change your diet as fast as you think you can. If only I listened to him. I, being smart, ate mostly cheese and meat sticks while going up to the base camp to go climb Glacier Peak.
Oh my goodness.
It went horribly poorly, gastrointestinally. And then a forest fire started nearby and smoked us out. At least I left. Other folks have been going. But I discovered that, in fact, Mike Mutzel was correct. You can, in fact, not change your entire diet in 1 month. And also, doing that as you're trying to literally climb a mountain is stupid. So my attempts to be extreme really didn't work.
Yeah, I think, kind of baseline diet and what you're used to and making adjustments over time. I'd love to hear Mark's thoughts on, what level of performance, let's say, or activity, you know, does this really become an issue? Because oftentimes what we see is people's perception of, what level they're performing at. And they hear someone, like Mark saying that, if you really want to, be a high level bodybuilder, you're going to need carbs. And they say, okay, well, if I'm going to the gym, twice a week and doing, kind of my 15-minute, 20-minute workout, I need carbs because Mark said I need carbs to be a bodybuilder. and I'd just love to hear kind of how you help people think about that and what sort of, framework you use with some of the people that you work with on when do you really need, carbs or X level of carbs, and when can you, you know, maybe get away without them?
That's a great, great question. And I think there's a lot to digest and a lot to unravel there. At the end of the day, I will just state this emphatically because I'm a man of science. Nobody actually needs carbohydrate. Like, carbohydrate is, your body loves it. Your brain takes it up first, glucose. Your body loves glucose, just likes using it. However, you don't need carbohydrate. It's the only non-essential macronutrient. You need essential fatty acids. You need essential amino acids. You don't need carbohydrate. There is no essential carbohydrate. I can make an argument and be argued with left and right about science being very supportive of fiber and the way it works in the body and it feeding the, you know, feeding your gut bacteria and also, you know, the link to that and lower morbidity rates. I think we can look at that. We can absolutely look at that, but we don't need carbohydrate. Now, if I'm a sedentary individual and I'm starting a workout program, going to the gym 3 days a week, I probably don't need to center carbohydrate around my training. However, if I'm someone who's looking to optimize their training, who does not want to cut carbohydrate or who just wants a balanced diet, some people just feel better and like life better. And some people aren't willing to give up certain foods. Like, it's good to know optimal, right? Like, optimal this, optimal that. That's great. Most people can't even turn down a Twinkie at the gas station when they fill up their car. So we have to be realistic. So when I see people who are training who like certain foods, I'm like, well, okay, we can maybe put those carbohydrate around training. You know, we could do that. But if you're looking at beating personal bests, if you're looking at going to the gym and training at a high level, if you're doing short bursts, meaning if you're going for higher intensity training, and you're doing a good amount of reps, you're burning through glucose, and you'll find, and I've done this, I wrote a book called The Carbohydrate Haters Diet. Like, I'm one of the OG carb haters, but as someone who's done it one way and done it the other, you know, I and many other people, and some people don't, the carnivore people obviously don't, they love their lifestyle, more power to them, find that training with carbohydrate is more enjoyable, you get better gains. And for those of us who are training for aesthetics, which are a lot of enthusiasts in the gym, you get that pump. You know, you could replace a lot of that with electrolytes, but it's still not the same as when you have adequate sodium, adequate hydration, and also carbohydrates. So I don't think there's a necessary level of athlete, but most people don't need, and I say need, carbohydrate. It just makes training and life more enjoyable for some. And for those like my wife, she's Italian. Like, you're going to tell her to stop eating pasta? Good luck with that. You know, so I'm a realist. Like, I love optimal and I like carbohydrate. I like toast and my eggs, you know, and that's something I want to eat every day. So how do I make it so that works best for me?
Yeah, I think great points. And, you know, I would certainly agree with sort of earn your carbohydrates and yes. you know, put them towards specific purposes if you're going to have them. You know, another interesting question that I think comes up around that is, okay, so how do I figure out, you know, how much, you know, and when do I know when I've crossed that threshold that it's too much carbohydrates or I'm not, you know, adequately using them, or perhaps it's the wrong type of carbohydrates. I don't know, you know, how much you've worked with continuous glucose monitors, if you recommend them for, you know, the people you work with. But I view them as a great tool for getting the feedback about, you know, is it too much carbohydrate? Is it the wrong type of carbohydrate? Is the wrong timing for your carbohydrate? Mm-hmm. All of these things, I think, can be fine-tuned with a continuous glucose monitor. And then, you know, with monitoring the right blood work over a more long-term basis.
Absolutely. My insulin, now I am a freak when it comes to blood sugar regulation and insulin. My insulin level, I believe, on my last blood work was 1. So I'm reading at ketogenic levels. Now, I also use insulin mimetics, blood glucose disposal. It's a product. Again, this is not an ad. I'm just telling you what I do. There's a product we made by Ambrosia, which is one of my brands, called Alchemy. And what it has in C2, which is a phenomenal ingredient, seaweed off the east coast of Canada. And it's the solvent used as water. It's really cool manufacturing. Berberine is another one. Mixed opinions on berberine because the data on metformin and muscle damage or, you know, preventing muscle gains. I never noticed that when I took metformin, but I've been a huge fan of insulin mimetics since early 2000s. I was in my 20s. You know, I was taking R-alpha lipoic acid. So my thoughts, if you look at all of the data and you come down to when is too many carbs? And I will say that a lot of times diets or macronutrient ratios on diets comes down to losing weight. So the number one thing is if you're fat, you're going to be unhealthy. If you're not fat, if you're of healthy weight, you're more likely to be healthy. So when is too many carbohydrates? Well, number one is I think you should hit certain things. Like obviously ketosis is different. I believe you want your protein at around 20 to 30% and your fat higher between 70 and 80. You correct me if I'm wrong, doctor, to stay in a ketogenic state. Obviously that changes as the longer you're doing keto, you can put more protein in. Whereas for me, what I like to do is I recommend people get at least a gram of protein per pound of body weight. So for a 200 pound male, that's 200 grams of carbs. Protein, thank you, carbs. For fat, I like 0.5 grams per pound of body weight, generally speaking. And that's not factoring in what kinds of fat. But generally speaking, so that'd be 100 grams of fat for a 200 pound person. And then what I like to do is fill the rest of the calories in with carbohydrate. So if you have, let's say, you know, 400 calories left over, that's 100 grams of carbs. So that's how I like to do it for myself if you're doing a macronutrient type thing. And I found that to work good. It usually ends up being around a 40-40-30, somewhere in there type macronutrient split. But I am not a super high carbohydrate guy. Now, for athletes who are burning a ton doing two-a-days for a basketball player, a football player, for a hockey player, soccer player, like my daughter, you know, like in season, you know, I'm going to kick that up and we're going to put that around training and we're going to make it readily available. And the data, albeit a lot of it was funded by Gatorade, because who else is going to fund it? Even the Tipton studies back in the 90s and early 2000s, we do have tremendous data on performance and intra-workout and para-workout carbohydrate intake. So when I look at all of that, I'm like, you know what? Yeah, we do need to augment carbohydrate intake for athletes, but that's an extreme case. For most people, the too much carbohydrate is enough to make you fat. Once you start getting fat, that's too much carbohydrate. Back down.
Yeah, the only thing I would argue with there is I think that, you know, you can be unhealthy without being fat. And I think so using the metric of when I get fat is too much may not be the right thing, you know. And I do think keeping an eye on things like your insulin levels, like your hemoglobin A1C, like your, continuous glucose monitor readings are important, because I do see plenty of people who aren't fat, but they are unhealthy. They're insulin resistant. And, you know, there are lots of things that go into that, you know, not having enough muscle. Being sarcopenic is certainly going to, you know, contribute to that, not being active. And then certain genetic backgrounds, you know, most notably Asian, Indian genetics are such that they get insulin resistant and diabetic without getting fat. And so those are some of the things that you want to look out for there. You know, I think your macro approach is great. You know, I also say one gram of protein for a pound of body weight. Awesome. You know, and then, you know, I say fat and or carbs are going to be to meet your energy demands. And it's going to depend where you're coming from. You know, if you're obese and you got a ton of body fat you're trying to burn through, then you're going to want to dial that down. If you're going for a true therapeutic ketogenic diet, you have some neurologic condition that you're trying to treat, heart failure, maybe some psychiatric conditions that you really need that high level of ketosis. Like you said, you know, kind of a 4-to-1 ratio fat to protein is what you're going to need to get there. But overall, yeah, Great approach. And I use a very similar approach with my patients. The difference being that most of them are not, you know, high level athletes or not high, you know, high performing bodybuilders. And so, you know, those ratios are going to end up looking different in the end, because most of them are coming with a background of insulin resistance, and therefore that carb threshold has to go way down. And again, I think that's just the different types of people that we work with. And this is where the, and that's why I think it's so great to be having this discussion.
Well, let's get your thoughts on this question right here from Danny Smith. Danny says, I lift weights about 5 times a week and do it fasted, but then after I eat 2 to 3 pounds of meat, both for Dr. Avedi and for Mark, how do you view this particular way of doing it, or what questions should Danny be asking to dial in his nutrition?
Doctor, would you like to go first, or would you like me to go first?
Yeah, I'll jump in first, I guess, on that one. So, yeah, I think I'm going to assume that, background here is that Danny's doing a carnivore diet. And so he's not having a bunch of other carbs and stuff with his 2 to 3 pounds of meat. But I would say it sounds like a great approach. It sounds like, you know, and especially if you're getting the results that you're looking for, everything sounds pretty ideal there for me. And I would just be saying you want to be keeping an eye on some of the metrics we talked about earlier and what your goals are. And are you meeting those goals is kind of a high level question that I would be thinking about in evaluating whether what Danny is doing is a good approach or not.
Yeah, doctor, I completely agree. The one thing I'd want to know, I always ask, like, what are your goals and where are you at? You know, like, is his goal to compete? Is his goal to run a 5K or play XFL football? You know, there's a lot of things involved before a general population person. And we're looking at, you know, I'm going to guess over 70% after 2020, all the data's from 2019. My good friend Alan Roberts always points that out. You know, we have a 70% plus obese population, overweight. Let's go overweight. Obese is a bit higher. I will put money on overweight. So if you're that standard person, you have plenty of fat stores. You have plenty of energy stored up. Go train in the morning fasted. Most of the mornings, I usually have a carbohydrate drink during training. Again, I'm extremely lean. My insulin sensitivity is extremely high. My body just churns through carbohydrate. We're different, right? I have high muscle mass, very low body fat. If you are a normal person, and I also want to know what else you're eating throughout the day, right? Like if you're eating 2 to 3 pounds of meat after working out, fasted, and then later on you go to Five Guys and get the big bag of fries and the cheeseburger, which is delicious, by the way. I would highly suggest that you probably step back. But as the doctor said, everything I say, and even before when we spoke about when too many carbs is enough, I think I love that. I think that we need to do blood work. Like we need to have at least annual blood work, and we need to measure those things. And if you don't have a doctor who knows what blood work, most doctors will give you a metabolic panel and lipid profile, and that's it. You need to run everything. You need to make sure they run all the A1Cs. You need to make sure they run all of that, not just metabolic, not just lipid, not just cholesterol, because we found out that cholesterol doesn't tell us the whole story. And also the scan, you know this better than I, but I got the calcium scan too.
Yep.
That is fantastic. So again, like, well, I can't afford it. I don't have insurance. Okay. Well, that's great until you're dead or until you have heart problems. You want to know what a big bill is? Go have a heart transplant. That'll cost you a ton of money. So if you have to invest $1,000 a year to get these tests run, they are less. It's cost me $50, by the way, $50 for my scan. So if you have to spend let's say it's $1,000, like it's the one thing you do a year. It's the most important thing you do. You need to make sure you know where you're at. And if you haven't noticed, like, I don't know if you've been following this doc, but a lot of bodybuilders have been dying of heart problems. And that's a whole nother conversation of why it's happening. We all have our, you know, speculations and reasons. But at the end of the day, make sure your stuff's in order, get it checked. But dude, here's the thing. If that diet's working for you, you feel great, you look great. I think from a, from an inflammation and an allergy standpoint, the carnivore diet's great. From if you have any seizure issues, whatever, you know, the ketogenic diet's great. There's two ways to look at things, but very few athletes, and there have been a few, can perform at their peak, again, going by the data available, without carbohydrate.
Okay, I have another question for the two of you.
Well, before, I just wanted to jump back in on cost of this stuff and just say that, yeah, well under $1,000, I think you're covered for a year. You know, a CAC scan, most places is going to cost you $100. You can get it as cheap as 50. You know, a good set of blood work, you know, that I order for my patients, that is, I think, very comprehensive, is going to be about $250. So if you do that two, maybe three times a year, you know, you're still under $1,000. And I certainly agree. It's a good investment in your health, because as you said, having a heart attack, needing, you know, advanced medical care for heart failure, heart transplants, all of that stuff is going to be way more expensive in the long run.
And your chances of dying afterwards, like how long do you live after a widowmaker heart attack average? Like 5 years, I think it was. It was not very long.
Yeah. So 1/3 of first time heart attacks are fatal. So there's a chance that you don't, you know, you don't survive the first one, and you don't want to mess around with that.
Yeah. So don't take your heart lightly. Like the number one reason to exercise is to get healthy. Looking good is a byproduct. That's a side effect, but you need to, again, like your heart, it's amazing how this thing even works. Think about it. It's beating right now. You're not even doing it. It's just going and going. And I don't know if you knew this, doctor, but last week my wife had an ablation. She had, SVT. She had SVT.
Yeah, SVT. Yeah.
And so, yeah, she had an ablation, and it's just all the things that can go weird in the heart, like all the things that can be genetically off. Just make sure you take care of that bad boy.
Next question. I'm curious from both your points of view, if we're looking at just body fat percentage, and let's talk just about men right now, what does looking good look like? And what does looking healthy look like, or feeling healthy?
I could take this one first since you took the last one. It's your show. You tell me.
No, go ahead.
So that's a great question. I think that, you know, when you're looking at body fat that looks good, I think there is a level of genetics, right? Some people just stay naturally lean. So for a lot of people to stay at the body fat I'm at, and I'm naturally active. You could tell I'm in a stand-up desk. I'm always fidgeting. So for me, staying at between 6% and 9% body fat is easy. It's just where my body likes to be. And my brother's the same way. My kids are the same way. You know, not all of my kids. I have a child that's the same way, right? Whereas for health, looking at it, like generally speaking, you could see abs at around 10% body fat, sometimes 12, depending on the thickness of your abs and your structure and your genetics. I would say, generally speaking, that anywhere under 20% body fat would be somewhat healthy. What you won't be fat, you won't be obese. I think 15% is what you'd consider when you look at those pictures of like the beach in like the 80s and 90s, I'd say they were probably around 50%. Nobody, 15, not 50, 15%. Nobody was really fat. You know, nobody was really, there wasn't a belly hanging over the waist for like, I wonder if that guy's seen his junk in a few years. Everybody looked healthy and well. So I think if you can maintain somewhere between 10 and 20%, that would be a great place.
Yeah, I think that 20% number is a pretty good cutoff as well. I would give a little bit more nuance maybe to the visceral fat versus subcutaneous fat. We know that visceral fat is particularly problematic. And even though you may have low, you know, in that 10 to 20% range total body fat, if you're carrying around excess visceral fat, that's going to be problematic. And, you know, measuring that comes down to, you can do DEXA scanning, you can do MRIs to quantify your amount of abdominal visceral fat, which is really, you know, most important measurement to be looking at for that. So that's the extra wrinkle that I would put in there is just it's not only total body fat percentage, but looking at your visceral versus subcutaneous fat levels is important as well.
Mark,
you know what that was? I have not. No, I did way back. I can't even remember what it was. It was back in like 2013. I have not. I'm a blood work, get the scan done, but I have not got a DEXA in a long, long time.
Well, so at what point of athleticism is it no longer that relevant because you can see the truth of what's inside you? Like at your point, the chances that you have some subcutaneous fat hiding somewhere seems pretty low. At what point do we know that we should do stuff like DEXA versus say, you know, other stuff is telling us that we're fine?
Well, I again, the doctor know more about this than me. Like this is not, I'm not going to pretend to be an expert at this. I'm not going to spout off, but I would imagine that there would be some telltale signs, that you're not as healthy as you think you are. Now in bodybuilders, extremely lean people, you could have abdominal distension, the beer gut, you know, you see that in athletes as well. I believe exogenous use of insulin does that to some athletes, storage of visceral adipose tissue. But I would love to hear the doctor's take on this because something I'm wondering as well.
Yeah, I mean, I think blood work is very informative here. I mean, and good blood work so that you're looking at your insulin levels, you're looking at your level of insulin resistance. You know, I would even point to something like lipid particle sizes, for instance, as information that can help you determine that you may not be as healthy as you look from the outside. Honestly, it's a tough one because we do sometimes see people who are very athletic, you know, performing at high levels, and you would never guess it. And, you know, they end up, you know, seeing me as a heart surgeon, end up on my operating table, or they end up having a heart attack. And it, you know, it's only in retrospect because they didn't have any of that blood work done. They didn't have the coronary artery calcium scans done, that we, you know, we figure out, yeah, you weren't as healthy as you looked. So someone who's trying to manage this prospectively and being proactive about it, I would say you really got to get the good blood work, you know, get your coronary artery calcium scans, yeah, you know, just kind of be paying attention to how you feel, how you look, but looking under the hood, I think at least once or twice a year with the blood work and with these scans is very informative. You know, one other thing about a coronary artery calcium scan I'll just mention is it's not only useful because of that coronary artery calcium number. But when they do the scan, they usually, you know, will scan down at least to your upper abdomen. And a good, you know, doctor, a good radiologist looking at that can look at that and see, you know, can get a sense of how much visceral fat you might have. So when my patients have these scans, you know, I always insist that I see the images myself. Because the radiologist will just read the coronary calcium part of it and they'll give you a score and that's helpful. But then I'll look at it and say, look, you know, we can see the fat around your liver here. And, you know, that's another problem sign to be looking at.
Yep.
Let's take the conversation in another direction, which is the average person in the US, like Mark said, is overweight, 70% at least. What is the path for someone who's listening to all this and they're looking at their own lab work, their physique, their abilities, and they're saying, yeah, I'm probably in that 70%. We know Dr. Avedia's perspective on here's how to go get started moving, but I'd love to hear from Mark, for someone who says, yeah, it's not great. What should I do next?
It's probably similar to what you recommend. Hydrate. You know, make sure you drink enough liquids, make sure you drink enough water. Hydration is key. Satiation to just body processes, to digestion, you need water. So that's out of the way. Go for a walk. An evening walk is a great start. 30 minutes. I'm assuming you're sedentary, right? I'm not assuming you're just a guy who goes to the gym every day and just had a little fun at Christmas. You know, go get up, go for a walk. If you're obese, now let me handle the obese first. obese people should not be going in the gym starting a hardcore training regimen. They literally need to just start moving. Swimming is a good idea. Walking is a good idea. Biking is a good idea. Bicycling, movement. And also, you don't want to just go from zero to 100. Like you see that on like The Biggest Loser and these shows. I think that's detrimental. You also want to think about what you can do to sustain this. Don't think about it as an immediate fat loss. You need to make this lead into a lifestyle change. And another thing would be exactly what the doctor says, eat more whole foods. Like the problem is, you know, these ultra processed foods, ultra processed, they not only make you fat, they not only have very calorically dense properties to them, but they also make you stupid. They inflame your body. They add to so many, I mean, there's so many bad things that come from these ultra processed foods, from your brain to your body. And total body inflammation is Satan. I've been saying that for years. An inflamed body is an unhealthy body. And I'm not talking about getting your muscles inflamed from post-training. I'm not talking about taking ibuprofen every day. I'm talking about that total body inflammation. So again, you also look at what fat does. It's estrogenic. You know, it's bad for your hormones in general. So when I look at someone who's obese, my number one thing is eat as much whole foods as possible, stay hydrated, and exercise, meaning go on a walk or go swimming. If you look at someone who's overweight, it's pretty simple. You know, there's many ways to figure this out. You have to eat in a hypocaloric state. Okay. If you want to measure your calories, that's one way to do it. And exercise, start an exercise program, whether that's lifting weights, whether that's doing P90X, whether that's doing CrossFit, whether that's doing jazzercise, whether that's joining a run club, you got to get that weight off. You just have to create a caloric deficit. That means eating less than you burn, basically. So once you get that, then you're on a good path. Then you just have to find a way to make it a habit and make it your lifestyle. And that's where people fall off. A lot of people will lose weight, but then they gain it back plus. And so that's why you need to make sure it's a lifestyle. You can't just look at it as a diet. You have to look at it as a lifestyle change.
Yeah, very much so. And you know, people are certainly familiar with my story. And, you know, I have a background of obesity and was able to lose weight many times, but never able to maintain it like so many people out there have gone through. And it was really only through the low carbohydrate approach that I've now been able to maintain that weight loss for, you know, 8 years and going. But it's a constant challenge. And like you said, if you're not going to be able to maintain it, if it's not a lifestyle for you, then, you know, the short-term gains rarely have a true impact on your long-term health. Great point there. And you got to find what works for you is another key part of this. Just because it works for Mark or just because it works for me doesn't mean it's what's going to work for you. And this is why there is no one right answer out there. And it's going to depend, like we talked about earlier, on your goals, on where you're starting from and where you're trying to get to.
And can I interject? I believe the low carb diet, as someone who doesn't follow the low carb diet, is the most dummy proof diet out there, because it's taken away probably 85% of your snack foods, potato chips, candy bars, you know, all those little candies, the runts, the nerds. Oh, it takes out all that stuff. French fries. It takes away the bun. You have a couple patties. It's more satiating. There's less swings in blood sugar and insulin. You don't have to worry about it. It's the low carb diet. And again, I'm not saying this to demean anybody, but it's pretty much, you know, dieting for dummies, you know, just stop. And it takes out a third of your optional macronutrients. There's protein, carbs, and fat. You take out one of those, you have less chances to binge. Also, I would add that I've never really seen anyone become obese eating just ribeyes. Like, you will get so tired of eating that after the, you know, second pound, like our guy before, 2 to 3 pounds. I don't even know if I could do that. 2 to 3 pounds of meat. I could, but that's a lot of meat, bro.
Like, you need to go with Dr. Avedia, yeah, to Fogo de Chao.
At Fogo de Chao, I can. I can there.
Yeah, well, yeah,
I can,
I'm just there. Saying.
Yeah. That place is delicious.
Yeah, exactly. And you're not going to eat again for a good 24 hours afterwards. So yeah, definitely.
All the sodium, all the sodium, I gained like 30 pounds. It's like so salty, but it's worth it.
Yeah. And yeah, I think that's very much, you know, one of the key, one of the things that makes low carbohydrate diets so effective is it really is hard to gorge on protein. You know, you can certainly overdo it with fat. But if you're eating whole real food, then that fat's going to be coming with enough protein that it becomes self-moderating.
Absolutely.
Well, let's talk about protein, and let's, as we have the two of you together here, let's get into some details on the specific kinds of protein that are more good or less good for people that are more sedentary or more active or more trying to do some peak performance kind of thing.
Yeah, I think this is a great question for us to dive into. And, you know, maybe we frame it as, you know, if you are going to be using protein powders, protein bars, you know, what types of protein you should be looking for, what maybe you need to avoid. I'd love to hear Mark's thoughts on this. And specifically, I'd love to hear your thoughts on whey protein versus, you know, the beef proteins that are out there now. I'm seeing more and more of the kind of hydrolyzed beef protein. And I'd love in these protein powders and protein bars, and love to hear your thoughts on that.
So I'm a quantity over quality type guy, meaning quality is good, but I like, if you get a gram of protein per pound of body weight, you're covering your amino acids, whether that's a good, like I you know, just full disclosure. One of my companies sells the number one plant protein at Vitamin Shoppe called Ambrosia Planta. So off just getting that out there that I am, there is a conflict of interest. I also sell a great selling whey protein, MTS Nutrition Machine Whey at Tiger Fitness. So those are my conflicts of interest. So I will say, with that said, the fact that I make money selling protein, it doesn't really matter. And let me explain. There used to be this big fascination with fast protein, slow protein, based on the data I referenced before from Tipton et al. I think Creeter was a creatine guy. I'm trying to think of, anyway, Tipton was the main guy. So we saw these results, around workouts. So our assumption was you needed whey protein around training for it to be the most effective, for it to be optimal. But then we found in further studies, which is why science is never conclusive, found in further studies that caseinate did just as well in some studies, not as well as others. Whey plus caseinate did just as well in some, not as well in others. And then egg, which used to be the benchmark of protein. So when we look at the protein sources, all I'm caring about is, does it have a complete amino acid profile? Does it cover all the bases? And at that point, whether you're eating chicken, whether you're eating steak, whether you're drinking a whey protein shake, whether you're drinking a plant protein shake, does it cover those amino acid bases? And are you getting adequate protein based on your body weight? So we can dissect things, and I can tell you biological value, which we can argue if it matters or not. If you're going by that, egg is 100, okay? Because it was what everything, it was better than everything. It was the best protein. You couldn't get better than egg. Then they were looking at like, oh, caseinate, cheese. Like, what's this other stuff, this whey stuff? Let's test that. Came out at 107. That's how it became 107, because it was compared to the former 100. So whey protein became the benchmark of protein. So arguing, I could say that you should only eat whey protein, right? But that's stupid. Then you're missing out on all micronutrients in steak and beef, which is, in my opinion, beef and organ meats are the most nutritious things you could put into your body. They have more nutrient dense than anything out there. So why am I going to tell someone to just drink my protein? That's stupid. That's disingenuous. So are there best types of protein? Yes. Does it really matter? Go with the one that your body agrees with most. Go with the one that you digest the most. Go with the one that you enjoy the most. You know, some people are lactose intolerant. They're allergic to dairy. I'm going to point them to Planta, my plant protein. Some people want the benefits of whey. They love the taste. They love the texture. They like the fact it's 107 BV. Go to that. Some people don't like powder at all. I'm going to tell them to eat a steak. So that's just me. I'm not that guy. You know, I'm very kind of I'm not the guy to make a stance on one or the other. I think you should vary your dietary sources.
And are there, so, you know, specifically, I know lots of people are somewhat critical of plant proteins because they may be an incomplete amino acid profile. If someone's looking at plant protein sources, what should they be careful about? What should they be looking out for to make sure they're getting this? And of course, you know, I agree with you, you know, it's unlikely that someone's exclusive source of protein is going to be, you know, a protein powder or a protein bar. It may be a little, maybe a little bit of an academic discussion, but, you know, I mean, someone who's trying to do it all plant-based, you know, they're vegan, vegetarian, just, or vegan trying to do it all plant-based. They're using some plant protein powder. What should they be looking out for to make sure that they're not missing some of the essential amino acids?
Well, I mean, it's the old school beans and rice, right? Like that forms a complete protein, but we don't want to eat beans and rice because to get 5 grams of protein, we need like 200 grams of carbs. So what we do is we go with pea protein and brown and basically rice. So brown rice. So pea protein and rice gives you a complete amino acid profile. What we did in the protein I made is we also added a vegan BCAA, which is derived from fermentation is the processed. So we put in a 2-to-1-to-1 BCAA, leucine to isoleucine to valine. So if you look at the amino acid profile of planta and you look at the amino acid profile of whey, it's way more similar. Is that even good English? It's more similar to a animal protein because what the plant proteins, the brown rice and the pea lack are adequate amounts of the branched amino acids, which we can argue all day about their validity, but we do know that leucine has certain, you know, anabolic triggers or triggers within the body for MPS and muscle protein synthesis. And then isoleucine and valine as a supporter. So when I look at proteins, I'm looking at, you know, does it have enough leucine, does it have enough isoleucine, does it have enough valine? Then I'm looking at the entire amino acid profile. So my goal, you know, as someone who designed a plant protein, is how do I make this as similar to animal protein as possible? So I think look at the overall the overall profile. So as long as you get a complete protein amino acid wise in there, I think you're in a great spot. But I will state that you can be a very good vegan. You can do really well building muscle, burning fat, being healthy as a vegan. You just have to supplement. You have to supplement with protein. You have to supplement with B12. You have to supplement with some form of DHA, EPA. I do not believe there's any way for a vegan to be optimal. I do believe you could be very good, but to be optimal, I do believe you need animal products in your body. That's my personal opinion.
Yeah, good to hear you say that. I would certainly agree. I think, you know, yes, you can do it. And I also work with, you know, and have vegan patients. It's just, it's pretty challenging and you got to do a lot of planning. One other protein aspect I'd love to touch on, one of the other sort of protein, you know, I'm not going to call it quite a myth, but misconceptions maybe that gets out there is this, you know, this limit on muscle protein synthesis, and you can only have, you know, 40 grams of protein at a sitting, and the rest of it, you know, your body's not going to be able to utilize. So I think I've, you know, kind of tried to debunk this a few times, but I'd love to hear your perspective on it.
So, I mean, the theory comes from MPS, muscle protein synthesis. I believe Lane Norton, and I forgot the other doctor, but they did the protein stat theory at University of Illinois. I believe it was in like 2010. And essentially they were showing that to maximize muscle protein synthesis, you need X amount of leucine. So to get X amount of leucine, you need X amount of whey protein isolate. And there you go. But it was around before then. So my question to you, not you, but to everybody out there. So let's say it's 30 grams or 40 grams or whatever. So is that for everybody? So I'm a 220-pound male, 6% body fat at 5'7.5" tall. Okay. So you're telling me that my protein intake per meal is the exact same as my daughter, who's about 130 pounds at 5'5", who's a female. So we both have the exact same intake? No. What really matters is what you've eaten, what you're going to eat. Now, obviously, for optimization, for my, again, everything we're saying, doctor, is interpretation. We're reading data, and I've seen people read the same data set and the same conclusions and read through the study. I'm not just read the actual conclusion, read through the study, and they have two different interpretations of the data. And we saw that with back in the day with the arachidonic acid study at Baylor. We've seen all these nuances in how you interpret data. My interpretation is optimal would be eating every 3 to 4 hours and getting, you know, 3 to 5 or so grams of leucine. However, that's not probable. A lot of people have different schedules. So what I'm getting at this roundabout way is a lot of people really overanalyze this. That's why I'm like quantity over everything. If you weigh 150 pounds, get 150 grams of protein, unless you like to eat one really big meal. And I think your body will figure it out. Your body will figure out what to do with the food. Just make sure you hit your intended targets for the day and you'll be good. For optimization, which I guarantee you less than 5% of our viewers right now will come even close to not to, to just being good. But for optimization, if I'm competing, if I'm getting ready for, let's say I'm doing the Toronto Pro next year, okay, I'm going to make sure my meals are on point. I'm eating at a certain level because every percentage counts. For most people who just want to look good at their high school reunion and go to the beach and not look fat, you know what? Just get in your gram of protein per pound of body weight. Don't worry about if you get 40, 50, 60, or 10 grams per meal. Just make sure you hit that end goal and you're 99% there. You're 99% there. Your body will take care of the rest.
I think that says it well.
We have some comments coming in from YouTube and everywhere else. We have friend of the show, Alan Roberts.
Yes, he's the guy I referenced earlier. Alan's, so he actually, the product I mentioned earlier, Alchemy, he helped design that with me. Alan is doing a great service to America by, he basically helps people get unfat themselves, is I think what we say now. But I don't know how politically correct you guys are, but Alan is not.
Wonderful. Then we have some other folks here. We have Ryan, who apparently is not even human and can just eat steak nonstop. Congratulations.
He's a lion. He's a lion. He's just yes.
And then we have a question here from Matt, a specific question from Mark here.
Okay. Why aren't there digestive enzymes in planta? Good question. And I'll answer that. Number one is, well, you could buy digestive enzymes and probiotics. We sell one. We actually sell one called Flora. And another is the dosing. Like if you have one or 20 scoops a day, whatever. Also with plant protein, you're not dealing with a lot of the issues that you have where you need a lactase enzyme to help break down the lactose for a lot of people, especially us Ashkenazi Jews, Asians, and Blacks, I believe, have the highest level of lactose intolerance. I don't know if I have those right. So a lot of people do need that. So I would recommend taking a probiotic. I always recommend people take probiotics. I don't know your stance on those, doctor, but I love probiotics. Huge fan of them for gut health and immune health. But another reason is, and this is something I found out the hard way, digestive enzymes, unless they're coated in a crazy expensive way, actually will break down the protein powder and make it go rancid. Think about it. It's an enzyme eating at your protein powder in the bottle. So it can definitely affect shelf life. A lot of people, when they say you should put this in your product, you should put that in your product, there's a lot of things I wish I could do, but from a chemical standpoint, these things just do not interact well together. They could decrease the shelf life. They can make it taste bad. And again, I can make the greatest product in the world, but if it tastes like crap, you're not going to buy it. So there's a lot of nuances to creating products. Did I answer that sufficiently? Let me know.
Probably, yeah, I think yes. that was a great answer, and something I never really thought about, that if you put the enzymes in the product, that they're going to be eating away at the product while the product's on the shelf. So
I have a story. I had a product. I owned a company called Cyvation, makers of the first intra-workout product Extend, that really took off. And we came out with a product called Solution 5. It was an MRP. You would have loved it. It was high fiber. It was higher fat, low carb, just fiber. And we put digestive enzymes in it. And in a month, the thing just imploded. It tasted like, I can't even describe how much money I lost on that. So I found out the hard way. So trust me, guys, I am speaking from a place of financial ruin and a place of love. When I say that, again, and there are enzymes that can go in there. They're cost prohibitive, and you're already spending $50 for 25 servings. I doubt you want to spend $70 for 25 servings.
And ultimately, you know, when you look at something like digestive enzymes, most people shouldn't need them. If you do, there's an underlying issue and you want to figure out what that is and address it. There's really no reason that people, the vast majority of people should need any sort of enzyme supplement to digest protein. Our bodies know how to do that.
It's kind of what we were here for. Like when we learned how to cook meat, that's when our brains really started developing as humans. That was the game changer for humanity, is the caloric density and the fatty acid content of meat and the protein. So yeah, your body knows what to do with meat. It just does. Lactose, we could argue that all day long. I like milk.
A few minutes left here, folks. Matt says, thanks for that great answer, Mark. Here's the last big question. Let's see if we can tackle this one in just a couple minutes here. I regularly encounter people who eat way less protein than I think they should, based on my association with Dr. Vaidya and hearing about a lot of these details all the time. Mark, what's the hack to get someone who's eating like 50 grams a day, 30 grams a day to change their behavior?
I'm gonna go straight up personal experience and bro, they're usually people who eat junk food. Usually people who like to eat sweet stuff. My only recommendation I could think of is Greek yogurt. Greek yogurt is the hack. It's got like 20 grams of protein for every like 3 grams of carbs. I mean, it is an insane hack. I think that just, people are naturally afraid of protein. I think women and children in the focus groups I've been a part of, they associate high protein with nearly steroid-like things. They think if you eat too much protein, you'll get an Adam's apple and grow an enlarged female woohoo. You know what I mean? So as much as I can make jokes about that, I won't. So at the end of the day, I think that just introducing them to high protein foods and telling them it can help them. It can help them lose weight. It can help them, avoid sarcopenia or gain more muscle, look better, feel better, and find things they like. There's a lot of options now. Have you seen those? You have core power drinks with 40 grams of protein at the gas station. You got protein bars like mine that give you 15 to 20 grams, depending on, which variety you go with. You got so many options of higher protein. And again, a little Greek yogurt cup is 20 grams of protein. The little ones they have at the hotels when you stay there, you know that doctor, because you stay at hotels. So, I mean, there's so many ways. And a gram of protein per pound, I was looking at that for my 10-year-old son. He's about 120 pounds during football, 110 during wrestling right now. And for him, that's 5 yogurt cups. It's not that big of a deal. Just put, and it also replaces the junk you would have eaten.
Dr. Vaidya.
Yeah. I think it really has been such a crime the way that protein has been demonized. And this, this concept that, 0.4 grams per kilogram was, enough. The recommended daily allowance, is enough protein is just, has really had such detrimental effects, because if you're not eating enough protein, the natural inclination is to turn to, junk food essentially, because you're going to be hungry all the time. So in terms of how to get your loved ones to do it, I think the best thing we can do is just model it and, show the results of it. It's clear that we all need to eat more protein. And like Mark said, we need to get away of this fear. Again, that somehow, the possibility that you're going to eat so much protein that it's going to somehow damage your health is really nonsensical. I mean, the studies on protein overfeeding are pretty clear that you can really eat excessive amounts of protein without any negative impacts on your health. So it really should just be eat more protein. And I think that should be a central part of our messaging around health.
Absolutely. Couldn't agree more.
Okay, folks, we are on the hour mark of all your websites. Where do you want to direct people to?
Go to tigerfitness.com, man. No matter what you get, no matter what you buy, I get paid there. And it also carries all the products from Ambrosia. So while you can go to ambrosiacollective.com, you can buy other stuff, other brands. Either way, I get paid, so I'm happy. But, hey, man.
Nice and simple.
I can't afford this cool like podcast equipment without that, you know?
Okay, Dr. Vaidya, who should go get on your calendar to talk with you at ifixhearts.com?
Anyone that doesn't want to end up on our operating table should go to ifixhearts.com and come work with me there first.
Okay, guys. Thanks for being here. We'll see y'all later.
Appreciate it.